Good morning, and welcome to our AMKMC Methodist Church online worship service. We're so glad that you can join us in worship this morning. This morning's service is a healing service, so let us be open to God's healing grace as we root ourselves in our identity as the sons and daughters of God, dearly beloved by our Lord and Savior. So please, as we enter into God's healing presence this morning, rise to your feet as we respond to this morning's call to worship. God is our refuge and our rock.
Our hope is in God all of our lives.
God has held us since our birth.
We are safe and secure in Him.
In love, God supports and sustains us. Together, trusting in God, we continually offer our praise.
Oh, Very good morning, AMKMC family. This is the time that we come together in corporate prayer. But just before we do that, give you a moment to say a personal prayer and praise unto our Heavenly Father. Kindly round up your personal prayers and intercessions, and let us join our hearts together, join our spirits together as we come together as a family for corporate prayer. O Sovereign Lord, you are the healer and restorer of our world. The second psalm says, "Why do nations conspire and peoples plot in vain?" Indeed, Lord, we read the news, we see power struggles and much politicking in many countries. We see United States of America swinging wildly in their policies with each passing administration, not to mention the civil unrest. We see China and their policies with Hong Kong and Taiwan, the rest of the world. And then there's continual unrest in Yemen. And so many of us continue to fight against COVID. Our world is indeed in such a mess, Lord. And we wonder what we can do as a tiny city-state here in Singapore. But Lord, you are the sovereign Lord. And when we pray with you, we know we are always the majority. And so, Father, we pray that leaders and peoples everywhere will come to the realization that only Jesus, the Prince of Peace, can bring about world peace, true peace. So, Holy Spirit, convict us deeply of our sin. Convict the world deeply of our sin. And help all of us to see our deep need for you, Lord Jesus, as our Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Here in Singapore, Lord, we do not want to take our peace for granted. Lord, we know religious extremism is always lurking in the corner, as we have seen in the news this week. We also know, Lord, that the foundation of family and gender are being challenged in every way. Help us, Lord, the church, to be your agents of love, justice, and peace. Fill us with both truth and grace. May we never compromise truth, but never let us be bigoted or worse, violent in advancing your kingdom. Lord, help us to be like you, Lord Jesus, for your kingdom is not of this world, but you desire for us to be salt and light, doing good, bringing glory to God, our Heavenly Father. And so, Father, we pray you help us to advance your kingdom, not in worldly wisdom or in man's wisdom, but in your love and your wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Lord, we want to lift up to you our speaker, Pastor Mihi, as he brings us your word this morning for our healing service. Indeed, Lord, you are not just the healer of the world, not just the restorer of the church, but you also heal us as individuals, because each of us are so precious to you. We pray for her that, Lord, as she speaks your word, the Holy Spirit will go forth powerfully to minister your word of healing grace to each of us and help us to live out according to your word. So bless her and bless all of us that we will receive your word and may it bear fruit in our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now let us family join together as we sing the Lord's Prayer.
Once again, good morning and welcome to the Ang Mo Kio Methodist Church online worship service. Here are some announcements that we want to bring to your attention. Please get your devices or some writing material ready to take note of the information. Or you may want to get the e-bulletin because all the information for these announcements can also be found inside. Firstly, here are some major changes to our on-site worship services for the month of February onwards. Do take note of these changes as you prepare to come for services in February. We will now be opening registration for our on-site worship services on a weekly basis, which means that you will be able to register and attend our on-site service every Sunday in February. The number of persons per service will also increase to 250 pax. In terms of the order of service, one change is that Holy Communion will now be conducted on the 1st and 3rd Sundays of the month, which will be the 7th and 21st for the month of February. Other than that, the order of service will still be blended, which means that it is meant for everyone, regardless of which service you use to attend. During each on-site worship service, we will be observing the government's existing safe distancing guidelines. This also means that you will need to have your Trace Together app or Trace Together token when you come for service. If you do not have either the app or the token yet, please get it ready by the time you come for service in February. Registration for each Sunday's service will open on the Monday before. For example, registration for the 7th February service will start on the 1st of February, a Monday. We want to encourage you to gather your family, friends, and cell members and make plans to come for service every Sunday, either at 8 a.m. or 5 p.m. The online worship service remains an option if you are not able to physically attend service on Sunday, or if you wish to share the service with your family and friends. Let's do everything we can to come and worship together at the on-site worship service. It is time to get back the habit of coming together physically to worship God. We hope to see you every Sunday in February. We want to remind you that today is our healing service. After the online worship service, there will be a Zoom prayer room for anyone who needs prayer. If you need prayer, especially for healing, we want to invite you to join us in the Zoom prayer room. Take note of the link that is on your screen, and you can go to the Zoom prayer room once the service is over. We'll remind you of the prayer room and the link towards the end of the service as well. We believe that God wants to work in your life and bring to pass His plans for you, and we would love to pray with you. Lastly, we want to remind you that registration has begun for the Discipleship and Nurture courses for 2021. Every year, the Discipleship and Nurture Ministry organizes various D&N courses such as Disciple, Companions in Christ, Master Life, and By This Name. These courses provide a variety of opportunities for you to grow in your spiritual walk with the Lord and to deepen your understanding of God. One such course is the 15-week study By This Name. This program is ideal for those who have little or no prior knowledge about the Bible. Using the Gospel of John, this study will help participants to grow in their understanding of Jesus and the story of the cross and the tomb. If you are a new believer, or you have never gotten into a serious Bible study before, then By This Name is an excellent starting point to begin your journey in studying God's Word. You can find out more about By This Name and also all the other D&N courses by going to the church website or the e-bulletin. Registration closes today, so don't wait anymore. Go to the website and sign up. There are other events and activities happening in Ang Mo Kio Methodist Church, and you can find them on our church website, in the e-bulletin, or by coming back to the announcement segment of this service video. Let's prepare to give God's tithes and our offering. Please get your phone and your iBanking app ready for the Offering Pay Now QR code. As we give,
let us learn not to hold on too tightly to our material possessions. Instead, let us recognize that our identity is in Christ and not the things that we own. And in so doing, we may then learn to be good stewards of the resources that God has placed in our hands. Brothers and sisters, we want to encourage you to give as the Lord guides, so that you may bless others and also contribute to the kingdom work done here in AMKMC. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come together to worship you on this Sunday morning. As we worship you with our offering, as we give to you what you have blessed us with, we pray that you will use it for your kingdom work here in Ang Mo Kio Methodist Church. And teach us, Lord, to give as you have given, Lord. Help us to be generous in spirit as well. We thank you, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Family and friends, having given our offering, let us rise to our feet and praise God with the doxology.
Praise God.
Savior, I'm happy and blessed.
my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all day long. This is my story. This is my song.
Good morning. We have now come to the end of the first segment of 1 Corinthians in chapter 4. The segment deals with the divisions in the church and the cause of the divisions, which is pride. Why are the Corinthians proud? What is the root cause of their pride? I think the root cause of their pride is that they are not sure of their identity in Christ. They are insecure. Pride is rooted in deep insecurity. The behavior of the Corinthians shows the characteristics of a prideful person, or I should say, an insecure person. Let's look at the characteristics of the prideful Corinthians. One, they derive their sense of significance from others. In chapter 1, verse 12, each of them, you know, says, I follow Paul, I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. And in chapter 4, verse 6, Paul told them that none of you may be puffed up in favor of one against another. Why did the Corinthians boast about whom they follow? Why did they elevate one leader over the others? The reason is likely that they try to get the sense of significance from their association with either Paul, Apollos, Cephas, or even Christ. They feel that they are as important as the leaders they claim to follow. The second characteristic, they were boastful. Chapter 1, verse 31, Paul told them, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Chapter 3, verse 21. Say, let no one boast in men. Boasting gives them a sense of superiority, that they are better than others. This compensates for their sense of insecurity. Third, they were jealous and competitive. Chapter 3, verse 3. There is jealousy and strife among you. Why do we find jealousy and strife in the midst? They don't want others to be better than themselves. They want to prove that they are better than the others. And fourth, they were critical of the apostles. Chapter 4, verse 5, Paul told them, do not pronounce judgment before the time. They criticize others as a cover for their own shortcomings. The pride of the Corinthians is rooted in the insecurity. This shows that they were not sure of their identity in Christ. In contrast, Paul and his fellow workers were sure of their identity in Christ and their calling. There was no need to prove themselves. There was no need to boast. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 4, verses 1 to 5. This is how one should regard us, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found faithful. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself, for I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness, and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendations from God. Here, Paul regards his fellow workers and himself as servants of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God. The word servant originally described the under-rowers. The under-rowers were chained below the deck of a galley, a warship. They had to instantly obey the drumbeat order of the captain. And you know, I think most of you would think of Ben-Hur, you know, in the film, and when Ben-Hur was an under-rower. And the under-rowers had to work hard under the harsh condition without any recognition. Paul also considered himself as stewards of the mysteries of God. A steward is a slave or a servant who manages the affairs of the master's household or estate. The steward was given authority and was entrusted with great responsibility. They are stewards very specifically of the mysteries of God. Mystery means things that are hidden and now revealed. Give you one example, the crucified Christ. It is unimaginable that the Messiah should be a servant king and not a conquering king. This has come through the revelation of God. So it's considered mystery. Paul and his fellow workers were servants of Christ and stewards of God. A Bible commentator aptly described them as the underlings of Christ and the overseer of God. The under-rowers perform a lowly service. The stewards are honorable and above all other servants. It didn't matter to Paul whether he was the under-rowers or the steward. Paul was secured in his identity in Christ. Paul seemed to embody what is stated in the Wesleyan covenant prayer. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will, rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you, exalted for you or brought low for you. So what mattered to Paul is to be obedient to the captain as the under-rower and to be faithful to God as steward entrusted in the mysteries of God. Paul was to be accountable to God for what he was called to do. God alone was to be his judge. He's not to be judged by others. As Paul was secure in his identity in Christ and his calling, he considered it a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. He was more concerned about how God should view him. And Paul is also not to judge himself. He continued, in fact, I do not even judge myself. He knew he could not be objective in evaluating himself. A very good example is that of Moses. In the first 40 years of his life, Moses was a prince in Egypt, and he was so confident that he can do anything that he wants to do. He was so confident that he was able, you know, to vindicate his people. Acts chapter 7, verse 22 say, and Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in words and deeds. In the middle 40 years of Moses' life, he was a shepherd in the wilderness, and he lost his self-confidence. And he said, I can't. And when Moses was called by God to lead the people out of Egypt, he said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? And then the last 40 years of Moses' life, he was a leader, you know, of the Egypt, of the Israelites. And he learned that God can. As of verse 3, chapter 12, God assured him that I will be with you. And Moses did miracles, you know, with God's help. D. L. Moody described Moses' life with three concepts like this. Moses spent his first 40 years thinking he was somebody. He spent his second 40 years learning that he was a nobody. And he spent the third 40 years of his life discovering what God can do with a nobody. Third, Paul is to be judged by the Lord and by the Lord alone. He said, "It is the Lord who judges me." The Corinthians should not judge him, and they should not judge him before the Lord comes. For only God knows the purposes of the heart. Only God knows the motive in human heart. So Paul went on to explain that he used himself and Apollos as illustration to get across his point. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 6 to 7, let me read to you. It's, "I have applied all these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, brothers, that you may learn by us not to go beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up in favor of one against another. For who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you receive it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it?" Paul urged the Corinthians not to be puffed up in favor of one against another. He admonished them not to show off his superiority. He then proceeded to ask three rhetorical questions. "For who sees anything different in you? Or what do you have that you did not receive? If then you receive it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it?" The answers are obvious. They have nothing to boast about. Finally, Paul admonished the Corinthians for being self-sufficient and self-conceited. Please read this section on your own. I won't read it for you. They thought they had become kings, independent of the apostles. Paul wished God's kingdom had indeed appeared, that they would rule with Christ. Paul desired the Corinthians to know that true servants of Christ must endure affliction and reproach. He realistically assessed his present condition. Instead of being at the top and reigning, he was at the bottom and faces persecution and death. Paul was sure of his identity in Christ and his calling. He was to please God alone. Galatians 1:10 says, "For am I now seeking the approval of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of God." That he was to be obedient and serve God in all circumstances. Philippians 3:12, "I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own." And Philippians 4, chapter 12, verse 13. "I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthened me." I entitle my sermon, "I am his, he is mine." We belong to Christ, and he has made us his own. We find our identities in him and are secured in his love. We can overcome the trap of pride in him, we can be set free to live and serve him with joy. Selwyn Hume's, in his book, Christ Empowered Living, states that most emotional problems arise from the sense of insecurity, inferiority, and insignificance. Our sense of security, self-worth, and significance can only be found in Christ alone. We are to be sure of identity in Christ. Our Lord Jesus has accepted us as we are. He has transformed us into his image more and more by his grace. We are secure in his love. We are precious in his eyes, and he has a purpose for our life. Let me now conclude with a testimony. A friend visited John Newton, the writer of the hymn Amazing Grace, at his old age. Newton read the scripture passage to his friends, including the verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am." Newton then commented, "I am not what I ought to be. I am so imperfect and deficient. I am not what I wish to be. I wish I would hate what is evil, cleave to what is good. I am not what I hope to be. I hope to put off immortality, all sin and imperfection. Yet, though I am not what I ought to be, nor what I wish to be, or what I hope to be, I can truly say that I am not what I once was. I was a slave to sin and Satan. Now I can heartily join with the apostles and acknowledge, by the grace of God, I am what I am." This Sunday service is set aside as a healing service. Let's take time to seek God for healing. In line with the sermon this morning, I would like to make special mention for emotional healing. Pray for God to heal us of our damaged emotion, our painful memories. Pray for God to take away our emotional baggage. And also take time to pause and praise and thank God with Paul and John Newton that by the grace of God, I am what I am. Let us pray. Lord, indeed, we want to thank you for your love and for your grace. And we want to praise you that, Lord, because of your work in our lives, we can become what I am. Thank you for accepting us. Thank you that, Lord, we are secure in your love. And this morning, even as we come before you to seek your healing touch, Lord, I just want to pray that your Holy Spirit will indeed be with us. And for those of us who are in need of healing, be it physical or emotional or even spiritual healing, Lord, I just want to pray that you will touch us and you will make us whole. Thank you that, Lord, you want us to be the best that we can be. You want us to be fully alive and victorious in you. Thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. There will be a Zoom prayer room after the service for those of you who need prayer for healing. The information will be on the screen, so you can just click the link and then log in. And there will be people, leaders will be there to pray along with you. God bless you.
Here are the class meeting questions for this week. We encourage you to join a cell group so that you can discuss these questions with them. The questions will be on the screen for a while more, so you may wish to take a screenshot or a copy of the question. If you are watching this after the Sunday service time slot, you may want to pause the video to take a copy of the questions. And even as we think about God's word and continue to respond to it, let us now respond with this song.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, in the love of Christ I stand.
In Christ alone, to confess, fullness of God in heaven's day, this gift of love and righteousness, sown by the ones He gave.
Thank you, Pastor Mihi, for sharing with us God's word today. We pray that we will all find our identity and worth in God and God alone. As Pastor Mihi has mentioned, today we have a Zoom prayer room available for anyone who is in need of prayer, especially for healing, whether it is emotional or physical healing. So please head over to the Zoom link found at the bottom of your screen after the service is over to join us in that Zoom prayer room. If you would like to contact any of our pastoral team members, you can head over to amkmc.org.sg/contact. Also, please remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel and to click on the notification bell icon so that you may be notified whenever we have new content that is released. Also, please remember to like, comment, and share this service video so that we may all share God's abundant grace which He has given us. Pastor Anthony, over to you for this morning's benediction.
And now, AMKMC family, the Lord bless you and protect you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant you His peace. Amen.